Obsession. Those were the words she said while the panic raged in the streets, and the great drawbridge of the Bastille fell with a thundering crash. It was a fateful day when she said, "Let them escape." She didn't know that the leavening of the meal would be that of blood, or the frosting for the cake would be horror. In a moment, you'll understand what I mean when you hear the story of a woman named Marie Antoinette, as portrayed by Beatrice Benedict in The Bloodbath. A story of a descending knife and severed head, and history's most terrifying obsession. This is the story of a bloodbath. A great inundating flood of hate that once overwhelmed the kingdom. It is the year 1769. Deep within the fastness of the Vienna woods, there stands a great castle. And within this castle, there lived the beautiful princess of Habsburg. Her name, Marie Antoinette. Sunlight is streaming through the stained glass windows of the royal council chamber as Maria Theresa, Empress of Austria and mother of Marie Antoinette, discusses a vital affair of state and of an obsession with her Prime Minister, von Konitz.
The document does not ask von Konitz. It demands that my daughter becomes the bride of Louis Bourbon, grandson of Louis XV.
Yeah, Your Majesty.
Stop saying yeah, Your Majesty, and tell me what you think.
Such a marriage would not be simple, Your Majesty.
Perhaps not, but such a marriage would mean peace between Austria and France, von Konitz.
Yeah, Your Grace, it would mean peace.
Mm-hmm. Well, well, you are a prime minister, not an echo. What is your opinion? What do you think?
The Bourbon is an ill-starred house, Your Majesty. A house that lives in eternal fear of the summer solstice. A time of inevitable doom for its members. The summer solstice is the time of year when all of the Bourbon blood expects tragedy. It is a curse which falls upon not only the blood of Bourbon, but upon those who wed with that blood and following that...
Godkin, and enough of this. Let us think less of superstition and more of our nation's welfare.
I shall execute your command, Your Highness.
I'm coming. What is that?
Thunder, Your Majesty, and rain.
Thunder, rain? At this time of year, don't come?
Yeah, Your Majesty. This is the time of the summer solstice. May God protect this house.
Such was the courtship of the 15-year-old Austrian princess Marie Antoinette, a pawn exchanged in the game of political compromise. Thus the gods of war are appeased, and the fair Prussian child Marie has become the bride of the feeble-minded heir to the scepter and throne, the Frank realm. It is now the hour of dusk, following the holy ceremony of marriage.
Louis? Louis?
Yes?
You are not angry about something, are you?
No.
Then what is it?
It is only that I cannot talk. I have no words. You may as well know now as later.
Know what?
What everyone in the court knows. That I am a stupid fool.
Louis.
That I am not as my brothers. I'm dull-witted. I'm clumsy. I'm someone they all laugh at. And now I...
I wish you would go away and leave me alone.
Leave you alone, dear? Oh, no, I could not do that. You are my husband, and I am your wife. And you must never say such things about yourself, for they are not true.
I cannot dance because I am clumsy. I cannot talk because I am a fool. I cannot... But why do I talk now?
It doesn't matter, Louis. I really don't care for parties very much. And I don't care for crowds very much either. You shall only do the things that you like to do, Louis. What do you like to do? Do you ride?
No.
Perhaps you like to hunt.
Yes. Yes, I like to hunt. Sometimes I hunt every week. Last week I shot a stag in the king's forest.
Did you, Louis?
Yes.
Oh, that must have been wonderful.
I like to make things, too, in my workshop. I have a beautiful workshop.
Yes.
Chopin says that I'm very clever.
Oh, did he?
Yes. One time I made a clock. It ran for 3 days.
A clock?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes, and sometime I shall make another clock. One that will... No.
Go on, Lee. One that will what?
You would not care about my clock or my workshop. You would only laugh at me as the others do.
No.
I wish you would go away and leave me alone.
But, Louis, I cannot go away and leave you alone. Nor do I want to. Louis, I am your wife.
Yes.
And you are my husband. And we are together, Louis, as we shall always be.
No.
How do you say no, Louis?
I hope that you shall be happy here.
But then,
go to the parties, you can dance, you can do anything you wish.
Louis.
I hope that you will have...
Louis.
I must tell you what everyone in the court knows, that you will never love me. For a woman can only love a man. A wife can only love a husband. And I'm neither one, do you understand? I'm neither man nor husband. Now laugh at me as the others do. I've told you. I've said it. Well, why do you not laugh? It is funny, is it not?
Oh, my God.
Now, I hope you will forgive me if I leave. I'm going to my workshop. I hope you will not be too lonely here.
And so began what was to be one of the great tragic obsessions in the annals of history. A marriage never to be consummated. A union of the ill-starred houses, Bourbon of France, Habsburg of Prussia. A mockery that was destined to end in the greatest bloodbath the world has ever known. In frustration and innocence, Marie Antoinette launched a career of wild and reckless abandon. Gambling, extravagance, dissipation. These are the channels into which the Queen escaped until she became known as the Scarlet Woman of Paris. And now, over France, there hangs black and lowering clouds. The storm of the people is about to break. A tempest, and it could lash the earth of the Frank realm with a mighty fury. Louis XVI is not a king. No more is he a husband. His infantile brain is incapable of guiding or ruling his domain. And thus he is unaware of the intrigue and plot that is turning rotten in the very core of the monarchy. The seeds of revolution have been sown, and the harvest is ready for reaping. In the palace, Louis stands gazing out of his window, staring into the blackness of the night, and reflecting upon the ominous prophecy of his grandfather. Ask me, the deluge.
Oh, Louis, what have we done? What sin sin have you committed?
Why should they hate us so?
I don't know. I wish I were not the king. With such a responsibility, I become confused.
Yes, yes. If this palace were only a small cottage in the forest, and if you were only a chief instead of a king, you could make things. Clocks. Oh, we could be very happy, I think.
Oh, yes. I should like that.
Louis, do you think it would be wise to say a few words to the palace guards to strengthen their courage against the noise?
I? You wish me to talk?
Only a few words, Louis. Tell them to fight for us, for their king. It would inspire them, Louis. It would help so.
Well,
please. It would mean so much.
Very well, if you think best, Antoinette.
Oh, yes, it is for France, Louis. The kingdom of France that you must speak. And I shall pray that God will give you the word.
Naturally, the mob. I thought that I should say a few words. That is, the Queen thought I should say a few words that we should all stand together, don't you think? We are facing desperate times, and I think, that is, the Queen thinks... the Queen thought I should say a few words, and... I have said a few words.
Back to your side,
please, Your Majesty, I cannot be responsible for my men.
No, no, of course not. I shall return to the palace now and try and be responsible for France. Thank you.
Horrifyingly prophetic words, after me, the deluge. And now the words are becoming a ghastly reality. It is the day of the vagabond, France, July 14th, 1789. Amid the tatters and rags and dirt and sweat of France, there beats a heart that must be warmed by a blazing flame, must burn with a white-hot passion, must beat out its one-word message until it reaches the heights of heaven. Liberty. Count d'Orléans, blood kinsman of the moronic Louis the 16th, has forsworn his nobility, has turned traitor to aristocracy, and now harangues the rabble. It's his Judas tongue that feeds the fires of revolution and the awful obsession.
People of France, citizens of France, before you stand the symbol of oppression, the symbol that reeks with the blood of the innocent, that breathes pitiless pride and contempt of the monarchy, it is the Bastille, citizens of France, and I say to you, in the name of France, in the name of liberty, take the Bastille, it belongs to you, take what is rightfully yours, down with the Bastille!
Count d'Orléans are finding their mark. The mob milled. Chaos and confusion embodied, centering its wild fury upon the outer drawbridge of the Bastille. Citizen Tournay raises his iron hammer to strike the chain that bind the great bridge. The links crack, splinter, and for an instant, the great bridge hangs. Then, the Bastille has fallen, and the deluge sweeps on. Within the lonely halls of the royal palace, Louis XVI wearily paces the confines of his regal chamber, his footsteps echoing the measured pulse of a heart that beats within his breast of the Austrian woman who is so upset.
Welcome,
Louis.
Yes. Possibly. Do you think they're coming for us if we
haven't
upset?
I don't know.
If they are, Louis, if they do come here, what can we do?
I don't know. Yes, come in.
Your Majesty.
Yes? What is it, sir?
Your Majesty, we are attacking the palace. You must escape.
Louis, what are we going to do?
There is nothing we can do, Marie Antoinette. We are still the King and Queen of France. And if it is God's will for us to die, then let us die like the King and Queen of France should die. There is nothing we can do but wait. I'm not afraid. I am not afraid.
And so the monarchy of France is no more. Lo, how the mighty have fallen. Louis XVI is tried before a tribunal of common citizens, found guilty of at least a score of capital charges, and sentenced to the cold embrace of La Belle Dame Guillotine, the woman with the knife. Marie Antoinette does not fare so well. Many weary weeks drag by before Monsieur Armand, tribunal president, considers the case of the once French queen, now the widow Capet. At last, she is led to the prisoner's cage, faced the false accusations of the 40 and 1. It is the serving maid, the half-crazed Milot, who takes the stand, bearing witness to the year 1788. The queen listens in stony silence, her face an expressionless mask. But with the mention of a final name, her face becomes livid. It is the name of her illegitimate son, who, forced by the skinny revolutionaries, charges his mother with the most unspeakable crime against society.
Have you any words to answer that card, Citizen Marie?
There are no words to answer that card, monsieur. Even nature cannot answer that card. I appeal to every mother in the court, to every mother in the world.
Citizen Cafe is found guilty of many nameless crimes, and the judgment is death. Back from the tribune halls to the cramped quarters of the lonely prison, this agonized creature of God with torn and broken heart is taken to await her execution.
Antoinette, Widow Capet, you have heard the sentence?
Yes. I have heard. I am to die.
Sic semper, madame. And so will die all traitors of France.
I lower myself to answer, monsieur. I was no traitor. I am no traitor. I was your queen in the life of Louis XVI. King of France. Is that the person?
It is not my place to argue with a cafe. I have come to offer you one last request. if you will but name it.
Oh, my son. My little boy. I should like to see him. To hold him in my arms. Just once more. That is the only request I have, monsieur.
You have no son, Widow Capet. He is no longer yours. He is the ward of the Republic. I am sorry.
I cannot see him. If only for a moment.
No, madame. Have you another request?
Yes. But death will come quickly. All will not do. Why have you and Austria forsaken me?
October the 16th, hour after hour, the pathetic Widow Capet waits, every moment torture to her anguished mind. Then there comes the fateful tread of the guard, and the summons in the name of the Republic of France. Marie Antoinette is removed from her cell, placed in a wooden cot, then down the steep, over the cobblestone, past the palace where she once ruled as queen. The Widow Capet makes her way to the rendezvous with La Belle Dame Guillotine. Marie Antoinette resolved to die the queen should die, still proud, regal, ascends the 13 steps into the shadow of the poised knife. The execution judge speaks.
Your Majesty, Marie Antoinette, before you die, is there anything you wish to say?
Yes. Yes, I am. In my humbleness, I could only have to repeat the words of one who passed my dad, but he not here. Father, keep my son, for I am not what I do. I am ready now.